السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بيرجو أكيلا شانزي زفر صاحبة لابد
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إذ قالت امرأة عمران رب إني نذرت لك ما في بطني محررا فتقبل مني إنك أنت السميع العليم فلما ودعتها قالت رب إني ودعتها أنثى والله أعلم بما ودعت وليس الذكر وإني سميتها مريم وإني أعيذها بك وذريتها وذريتها من الشيطان الرجيم فتقبلها ربها بقبول حسن وأنبتها نباتا حسنا وكفلها زكريا
مولانا خان
Chapter Ali Al-Imran, verses 36 to 38. I seek refuge in Allah from Satan, the accursed. In the name of Allah, the gracious, the merciful. Remember when a woman of Imran said, My Lord, I have vowed to thee what is in my womb, to be dedicated to thy service. So do accept it of me. Verily, thou alone art all-hearing, all-knowing. But when she was delivered of it, she said, My Lord, I am delivered a female. And Allah knew best of what she had brought forth, and the male she was thinking of was not like the female she had brought forth. And I have named her Mary, and I commit her and her offspring to thy protection from Satan, the rejected. So her Lord accepted her with a gracious acceptance and caused her to grow an excellent growth and made Zachariah her guardian. Whenever Zechariah visited her in the chamber, he found with her provisions. He said, O Mary, whence hast thou this? She replied, It is from Allah. Surely Allah gives to whomsoever he pleases without measure. Zakur.
Sadi Ayatullah.
السلام علیکم حضور منظوم کلام حضرت مسلم مودود رضی اللہ تعالیٰ
خدمت دین کو ایک فضل الہی جانو خدمت دین کو ایک فضل الہی جانو اس کے بدلے میں کبھی طالب انعام نہ ہو اس کے بدلے میں کبھی طالب انعام نہ ہو دل میں ہو سوز تو آنکھوں سے رواں ہو آنسو دل میں ہو سوز تو آنکھوں سے رواں اسلام کا ہو مقص فقط نام نہ ہو تمہیں اسلام کا ہو مقص فقط نام نہ ہو عادت ذکر بھی ڈالو کہ یہ ممکن ہی نہیں عادت ذکر بھی ڈالو کہ یہ ممکن ہی نہیں دل میں ہو سنم لب پہ مگر نام نہ ہو دل میں ہو عشق سنم لب پہ مگر نام نہ ہو اپنی اس عمر کو ایک نعمت عظما سمجھو اپنی اس عمر کو ایک نعمت عظما سمجھو سوائے ایام نہ ہو بعد میں تاکہ تمہیں شکوائے ایام نہ ہو ہم تو جس طرح بنے کام کیے جاتے ہیں ہم تو جس طرح بنے کام کیے جاتے ہیں آپ کے وقت میں یہ سلسلہ بدنام نہ ہو آپ کے وقت میں یہ سلسلہ بدنام نہ ہو میری تو حق میں تمہارے یہ دعا ہے سایہ رہے ناکام نہ ہو سر پہ اللہ کا سایہ رہے ناکام نہ ہو خدمت دین کو ایک فضل الہی جانو خدمت دین کو ایک فضل الہی جانو اس کے بدلے میں کبھی طالب انعام نہ ہو اس کے بدلے میں کبھی طالب انعام نہ ہو
Report side of the first ever.
Assalamu alaikum, Huzoor and Appa Jan. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the lead up to today's National Ijtima, a lot of work has been done throughout the year all over the UK within the 12 regions. Each region has a regional coordinator who all work very hard with the help of their local reps. Every majlis is encouraged to hold weekly classes. These classes include religious and social learning. Each month, they have a different topic to cover, decided and sent to them by the centre, which is usually followed by a task or activity. In total, there are 132 majlis in the UK. In July last year, most regions held a one-day, or in some cases, three-day residential tarbiti classes, focusing on the book Life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was also an open book online test following these classes. Regions have also held their ijtimas prior to today's national event. During the past year, alhamdulillah, myself and members from my team have managed to visit 7 regions and got the opportunity to meet with the local reps and the Waqfat-e-Nau girls themselves. And discuss any issues or problems which they may be facing. This year, the Waqfat-e-Nau department has produced 3 different books for the girls. The books are designed for ages 7 to 10, primary school, 11 to 17, secondary school, and 18 plus. Every month, every age group has the same topic, but it is explained to them in an age-appropriate way, followed by activities and tasks which they can do at home. These books were designed to help the local reps with what and how they should teach the girls, and to bring uniformity to their learning across the country. Moving on to today's event, all Waqfat-e-Nau from the age of 7 were invited through a letter from the centre. Our current tajneed is 1,966, out of which 1,534 are over the age of 7. Alhamdulillah, today's attendance is 984. As well as the Waqfat, we also have parents, teachers and guests, which brings the total attendance to 1,556. This morning we began at 8:30 a.m. with registration and breakfast, followed by the opening session at 9:30. The girls were then split into age groups of 7 to 9, 10 to 17 and 18 plus. They had a rotation system between the workshops and the annual test. The subject of the workshops were designed with different ages in mind and what may be beneficial for them. The 7 to 9 age group had an activity session organized by the girls of the AMSA team, which included a quiz, contemporary issue scenarios, and games. The 10 to 17 age group had a workshop about careers and their roles as a Waqf-e-Nau girl. The 18 plus girls first had a workshop on the topic, how to be an empowered Ahmadi Muslim woman in today's society, followed by a question answer session with the panel from members of the National Lajna Imala. This year, we also held separate workshops for the mothers who had come with their daughters. The first workshop was led by National Secretary Tarbiyat on the topic of the role and responsibilities of the parents of Waqf-e-Nau child. The second workshop was on the topic of how to deal with difficult contemporary issues. These were both interactive sessions designed to get ideas and help from one another. At 1 p.m., we had a break for Salat and lunch. The afternoon session began at 2:30 p.m. While the 18-plus girls went up to do their tests, everyone else, including the mothers, were shown a presentation about the activities of Waqf-e-Nau in the past year. This included many photos from all over the UK of girls doing many activities, including visiting old people's home, other religious places of worship, picnics, sporting activities, and much more. This was to give new ideas of activities and to encourage other majalis to do even more in the coming year. This was followed by two short presentations, one by the AMSA president and one by the National Secretary for Tariq-e-Jadeed and Waqf-e-Jadeed. This year, we had 13 girls who have memorized the entire Qasida and 33 girls who were awarded for various other academic accomplishments. We were not able to give out these awards due to the lack of time, but they will be given out on a later date. On top of this, there are also two girls who have memorized the entire Holy Quran, and I would like to humbly request Hazur Akdas, may Allah be his helper, to present them with their prize. Also this year, we began a grading system for the regions who have made outstanding efforts and achievements throughout this past year. The winning regions submitted reports on time, held regular classes, completed monthly targets, as well as other activities. We would be most grateful if Hazur-e Akdas, may Allah be his helper, would kindly present these prizes also to the regional coordinators. In the end, I would like to thank all the members of Lajna and my personal team who tirelessly worked for the success of this event. May Allah bless them all. We are also very grateful to the Secretary of Waqf-e-Nau UK, Masroor Ahmed Saib, and his team, who have helped us prepare for the event as well as assisting us throughout the day. May Allah Almighty accept all of our humble efforts. But most of all, we would like to convey our most sincere thanks to Hazur-e Akdas, may Allah be his helper, and respected Appajan for taking time out of your immensely busy day to be here with us today. Jazakallah. The two girls who are Hafiza, who are receiving awards, are Ashia Bajwa and Afia Nasir. Ashia Bajwa and Afia Nasir. Barakallahu lakum. In the regional awards, in third position, we have the East Region, Mrs. Farzana Ahmed. is the regional coordinator for East Region. They take the third position. In second position, we have London Region, and their coordinator is Mrs. Shimama Bajwa Saiba. And in first position, we have Islamabad Region, and their coordinator is Ismat Sana Saiba. Second prize goes to London Region, Mrs. Shimama Bajwa Saiba. And first prize goes to Islamabad Region, Mrs. Ismat Sana Saiba. Barakallahu lakum.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Today, with the grace of Allah, you are all attending the National Waqfat-e-Nau Ijtema, which is arranged for those girls in our Jamaat whose parents pledged their lives for the sake of their faith before they were born, and who, upon reaching the age of 15, have voluntarily renewed that pledge. Thus, you have willingly chosen to dedicate your lives for the service of the Jamaat, and given this, it is imperative that you continually reflect upon your moral standards and religious knowledge. You must ask yourselves if you are truly ready to serve wherever and whenever the Jamaat call you for service. MashaAllah, having grown up here, you have all been blessed with many educational opportunities. And so it can be said that you are all well educated. Even those of you who are comparatively less educated than your peers are still far more well read than the majority of girls who grew up 50 or 60 years ago. And if we rewind the clock further to the late 19th century or to the early 20th century, the girls and women of that period hardly had any educational opportunities at all. Similarly, in terms of both secular and religious knowledge, very few Muslim girls had the opportunity to pursue secular studies or to learn about their faith and to increase their religious knowledge. This is quite astounding and deeply regrettable, given that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed great importance and value upon the education and moral training of women and girls. Yet, over time, this instruction of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was increasingly ignored amongst Muslims, and so Muslim women became far less educated than men. A major cause of this unfortunate trend was the fact that many so-called religious scholars from amongst the ulama, so-called ulama, I should rather say, did not want religious knowledge to be shared or spread either amongst men, but especially amongst women. In contravention of Islamic teachings, they desired for women to be confined solely within the four walls of their home and did not even permit them to gain a basic education. Such attitudes were extremely harmful to the long-term progress of Islam because it was not possible for Muslim women to do the moral training of their children when they themselves had no knowledge of their faith. Yet this extremely selfish attitude prevailed across the ages and continued until Allah the Almighty sent the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam for the sake of the revival and rejuvenation of the true teaching of Islam. Upon his advent, where the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam emphasized the tarbiyat of men and encouraged them to be educated, similarly, he encouraged Ahmadi women and girls to seek both secular education and religious knowledge. In fact, there was a time when the Prophet Messiah himself used to personally conduct religious classes with women. Through the blessed guidance and subsequently through Khilafat Ahmadiyya, Ahmadi women came to understand the significance and value of gaining an education and of seeking religious knowledge. Certainly, throughout its existence, our Jamaat has continued to promote and support the education of women and girls, and many programs or schemes have been set up to facilitate this. A prime example are the schools and the colleges established by Hazrat Muslim Aud radhiyallahu anhu, first in Qadian and then in Rabwa. Through these centers of learning, those girls who could not afford to travel to bigger cities to study were provided a proper education and were able to attain high standards of secular knowledge and religious teachings. A huge added benefit of these schools and colleges was that our girls could attain education in a safe and moral environment, rather than having to travel to towns or cities where such an atmosphere did not exist. Having our girls educated in a safe and moral way is also a great challenge that we face today, especially here in the Western countries, where the commonly held belief is that it is only due to the so-called freedoms that they have afforded that they are progressing. However, in this belief, they are wrong, and there are many dangers and pitfalls that exist in these societies. And so all our girls, and particularly members of Waqf-e-Nau, must tread very carefully. Whilst you should seek to excel in your studies, you must be careful that you never betray your Islamic values and never forsake the responsibilities placed upon you by your faith. As I have said, our Jamaat has always promoted the education of girls. And a byproduct of this is that in some parts of the world, particularly in developing nations, but also in the Western world, we are seeing that Ahmadi girls take their studies more seriously than boys and are outperforming them. Whilst I am happy that our girls are shining in this manner, one issue that has arisen is that when it comes to deciding upon possible rishtas, some of our young Ahmadi women desire only to marry men who are educationally on par with them. Of course, our boys and young men should focus on their studies and work diligently. But if a girl gets a marriage proposal from a good and pious Ahmadi, she should not reject it just because the person is not as educationally qualified as she would like. The priority is in deciding upon a marriage proposal should always be righteousness and seeking to ensure that you can live the rest of your life in a home where the true values of Ahmadiyyat are always practiced. Anyway, in terms of the importance of education itself, always remember that knowledge can only prove beneficial when used for the sake of upholding your religion and faith. And the primary way to utilize your knowledge for the sake of your faith is to fulfill the rights owed to Allah, the Almighty, and to fulfill the rights of one another. Foremost amongst the rights owed to one another is the duty of a mother to raise and educate her children, be they boys or girls, in a pious fashion, so that they grow to excel and prove to be great assets to their nations. However, nowhere does Islam say that women should be confined to the home, as is sometimes alleged. For example, there are some girls and ladies who excel in studies and achieve extraordinary results, and Islam does not instruct that they should waste their talents or skills and only stay at home. Islam does not restrict them from fulfilling their potential. Rather, they can pursue those professions through which they can benefit humanity and serve mankind. Thus, women who have the capacity to become doctors or teachers or to pursue other professions which are of benefit to humanity can do so. However, at the same time, they should not ignore their duties to their children and to their families. Such women should manage their time effectively and ensure that their children are not neglected in any way. Certainly, the first priority of an Ahmadi mother must always be the moral training of her own children. Consequently, members of Waqf-e-Nau who, having acquired high level high level degrees or qualifications, desire to make use of their skills professionally, must ensure that they also fulfill the responsibilities of their home. Equally, those girls who are well educated but who do not go out to work professionally should never bear any form of inferiority complex or feel embarrassed or as though they are wasting their talents. The truth is that looking after your homes and caring for and raising your children is of profound importance and of priceless value. Generally speaking, Islamic teachings have ascribed a division of labor between the sexes, and it is a great favor of our religion that it has made our respective roles and responsibilities so clear. Nonetheless, Islam has catered for all possible circumstances. And so, even apart from professionals, there may be special conditions where women need to work. For example, during the time of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, women worked as nurses to aid those who had been injured during the battles and wars that took place. Indeed, a few Muslim women even fought on the front lines and showed magnificent courage and bravery. Anyway, as I mentioned before, you are the people whose parents pledged your lives for the services for the service of Islam, and many of you have now reached adulthood or are fast approaching it and have renewed that pledge for yourselves. The question is, why did you renew the bond of waqf? Why have you pledged your lives to the Jamaat? You should reflect upon this, as you can only fulfill your pledge if you understand what it entails and requires. By being a waqfino, you have promised that you will forever give priority to your faith over all worldly and material things. Hence, alongside your secular education in your schools and colleges, it is of paramount importance that you also strive to gain religious knowledge, because until you know what your religion teaches and expects, you cannot live your life according to its teachings. First and foremost, it is essential that you all read the Holy Quran with translation and study its commentary as much as possible. Only by becoming familiar with the Holy Quran will you be able to clearly understand the commandments of Allah, the Almighty. Knowledge of the Quran will be the means of your spiritual progress and will enable you to do the tarbiyat of your own children. Seated in front of me are several waqfatino who are now mothers themselves, but there are also working in various professions. So you are mothers, and at the same time you are working in various professions. And so I would again remind them that they must divide their time in a way that the moral training and well-being of their children never suffers. There are also many young women present who are now engaged to be married, or rather I should say there are young girls present here now engaged to be married, and so inshallah their family lives will soon begin and they should enter the next stage of their life, knowing that their first priority is to train their children. If you fulfill this primary duty, it will not only benefit you and your family, but your efforts will also prove to be a source of pride and benefit to your nation, because you will have instilled positive values into the next generation. You will be ensuring that your children grow to be role models who will understand their duties to those who follow them. In this way, you will be the foundation for a cycle of perpetual humanity, morality, and peace amongst the coming generations. By training your children according to Islamic teachings, you will not only be a means of protecting them, but also the generations that follow as well. Remember that the key for any nation to thrive and progress lies in the hands of the mother of that nation. In terms of the status of women in Islam, we need look no further than the teachings of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during the period when Islam was being attacked and defensive wars were fought by the Muslims. At the time of that jihad, many Muslim men were martyred, and as well as we all know, the rewards and blessings associated with martyrdom are vast. Consequently, a Muslim woman asked the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that since they were not permitted to fight and were being deprived of the blessings of jihad, that is jihad of sword and martyrdom, will they get the same reward as men by merely looking after their home? In reply, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told that woman that if they fulfilled their duties to their home and if they did the moral training of their children and raised them to be pious Muslims, then their reward would be equal to the reward of the men who went and engaged in jihad. In this era of the Prophet Messiah al-Islam, the conditions for a physical jihad of the sword no longer exist, because no nation or group is raising a physical army against Islam, and the tactics used by its opponents today are quite different. Rather than physical warfare, they are attacking Islam through the publication of anti-Islam literature, through the media and internet, and through their own forms of missionary work. Accordingly, we are now in a period where education is the key to challenging this propaganda by waging an intellectual jihad through those same mediums that are being used to target Islam. It is not only men and boys who can take part in this jihad of the pen. Rather, our women and girls can and must take part. Amongst our ladies, the members of Waqf-e-Nau should lead this effort. And so once you have attained a good education, you must not waste any opportunity to defend Islam from the false charges that are being leveled against it. This is another reason why it is necessary that you gain religious knowledge so that you can respond to the different religions made, different allegations made, and remove any misconception that exists. Without any fear, embarrassment, or complex, you should respond boldly to the false claims that are made because you have truth on your side. In this era, many of the allegations raised against Islam center around women's rights. And so, you should particularly focus on responding to them. For example, it is often alleged that Islam oppresses women and forces them to remain confined within their home at all times. Similarly, it is said that hijab is a means of subjugating women. Another common allegation is that women are denied their basic rights by Islam, even though Islam is that religion which from the outset guaranteed the rights of all women. It is that religion which liberated women and established their true status and honor. It is only in the past century that those people and nations who condemn Islam have been forced to afford some basic rights to women, and yet they still try to claim moral superiority. Furthermore, in the name of freedom, they have fostered an environment in which women are treated as objects, and their dignity and true status is constantly undermined. Anyway, as I said, it is your duty to defend the noble teachings of Islam through the media and other similar means. Thus, a central team of Waqf-e-Nau should be established for this purpose. And similarly, there should be local teams in different regions and cities as well. It is you, our Waqf-e-Nau girls and ladies, who must take on the mantle of educating the world about the meaning of true dignity and explain how the rights of women have been protected by Islam. For this, you must, as I have already said, read and study the Holy Quran, and also read other Jamaat literature as much as possible. The knowledge you will gain from such study will provide you with the intellectual power and capability to overcome the argument of those who oppose our religion. In terms of the importance of seeking knowledge, Hazrat Muslim Aud Rajitala Anho once remarked that until our Ahmadi women were not fully educated. It is 100% of our Ahmadi women are not fully educated. It would be impossible to train the youth of our Jamaat. This comment was steeped in truth and wisdom. If 10, 20, or even 50 or 60% of our women are well educated and knowledgeable and raise their children in the best fashion, it will still not be enough. The reason is that their children will meet other Ahmadi children whose mothers are not educated or do not have sufficient religious knowledge, and such children will have a negative effect on them. Therefore, for a true, righteous, and spiritual community to develop, we need every single Ahmadi mother and father to play their respective roles. If one person or one family is weak, it can easily have a knock-on effect upon the next. Conversely, if all Ahmadi families set a positive example for their own children, it will ensure that we can create a spiritual and Islamic atmosphere, even whilst living here in the West. Through your schools and colleges, you all have easy access to secular education. But as I have said repeatedly, you must pursue religious knowledge alongside it. Otherwise, if you abandon your religious teachings and traditions, the worldly knowledge you attain will not be of any real value or benefit to you. Again, I urge you to study the Holy Quran as much as possible and read the books of the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam and whatever other Jamaat literature is available in English. Furthermore, you should listen to my sermons and try to act upon whatever I ask of you. Indeed, you should consider the sermons of the Khalifa Waqt as a ready-made code of conduct for you to live your lives by. As I said, it is your duty to respond to the allegations made against Islam in the West, particularly those that relate to women's rights. You must respond not only through your words, but also through your conduct. For example, you should maintain a good standard of parda at all times. Just a few months ago in Canada, I delivered a sermon in which I listed around 34 or 35 special traits that members of the Waqf-e-Nau should strive to attain. I highlighted those qualities that ought to be the hallmarks of Waqf-e-Nau, and so you should keep them in mind at all times and assess to what extent you are practicing them. You must also be regular in namaz and always pray that Allah blesses your efforts and enables you to utilize your education and knowledge with wisdom. On one occasion, Hazrat Muslim Aud radhiyallahu anhu narrated an incident of an Ahmadi girl who had completed her bachelor's degree. And so she was advised that having attained high qualifications, she should try to spread the teachings of Ahmadiyya amongst other educated people through Tabligh. However, in response, she remarked that she did not attain such qualifications and education in order to cause division, and that she felt doing Tabligh was a means of sparking conflict. Having narrated this, as Muslim Aud Rajital Anho remarked, that her response was not of an educated or literate person, but was the response of someone who was ignorant and illiterate. Thus, none of you should fall into this trap. You should understand and recognize the opportunities Allah has blessed you with, and seek to use whatever knowledge you have gained for the sake of the defense and propagation of Islam. At this time, I also wish to clarify another allegation that is often leveled against Islam by its opponents, and regrettably is even believed by some Muslim men and women. The allegation refers to the hadith in which the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he had seen a vision of hell in which there were many women who had no knowledge of their religion, who displayed no wisdom or intellect, and who were ungrateful. Based on this hadith, certain non-Muslim critics have alleged that Islam has belittled and maligned the status of women. Yet, nothing could be further from the truth. Hazrat Muslim Aud Radhiyallahu Anhu has given a detailed commentary and interpretation of this hadith, in which he notes that the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was referring to specific weaknesses that existed in some women of that time, whereby they were illiterate, ignorant of their faith, and ungrateful for the favor bestowed upon them. Hence, the words of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam were given as a warning for such women to reform themselves. Yet, during the same era, we also see Muslim women scaled the highest peaks of morality, virtue, and knowledge. For example, some women, notably Hazrat Aisha, taught Islam to the Muslim men. Similarly, some fought in battle alongside the men and gave great sacrifices. Further, as I mentioned earlier, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that women who trained their children and looked after their homes would be the recipient of the same rewards as those who had engaged in jihad. Thus, how could it be that such devout and pious women were bound for hell? It is impossible, and anyone who claims this has entirely misrepresented the teachings of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. As I said, this hadith was a warning and note of caution to the women of that time. It was also a means of inspiration, as the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sought to raise the spiritual standards of the Muslim women and showed them the means of unlocking the doors to paradise. Never did the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say that these weaknesses or sins were part of the nature of women. Rather, he counseled that they were bad habits that had developed amongst some, whilst nature is something inherent and permanent, bad habits can be changed and improved upon. Just as the Holy Prophet ﷺ repeatedly drew the attention of Muslim men to their weaknesses and taught them how to reform, similarly, he guided the women as well. It is a cause of deep sorrow that this hadith has regularly been misinterpreted and abused by certain so-called Islamic scholars who have hatefully claimed that these words prove that women are wrongdoers, lacking in wisdom, knowledge or judgment, and who are, God forbid, bound for hell no matter what. Nothing could be further from the truth. As I said earlier, many of the so-called ulama did not wish for women to progress, and so they purposely interpreted this hadith in a completely wrong fashion in order to fulfill their own selfish agendas. These words of the Holy Prophet ﷺ were spoken only as means of reformation so that women could fulfill their potential and raise their status. We Ahmadi Muslims are truly fortunate that the Prophet Messiah ﷺ has enlightened us to the ignorance of the other ulama and saved us from their fabrications and foolish interpretations. Thus, it will be grave and perilous mistake for any woman to believe, having heard the false interpretation of the so-called scholars, that she lacks the capability to harbor knowledge, that she is inherently ungrateful, or that there is no point in learning her faith, as she is destined for hell no matter what. It is when a person gives up and believes that there is no chance of reformation or improvement, that weaknesses and sins increase. Tragically, some Muslim women have come under the influence of certain non-Ahmadi Maulvis, and so have become prone to the belief that they are somewhat inferior to men. This is completely wrong and erroneous. No woman should ever accept the false notion that somehow they are bound for hell, inferior to men, or unable to knowledge or wisdom, to gain knowledge or wisdom. Let it be crystal clear that in no respect is a woman's status less than that of a man. Rather, the Holy Prophet ﷺ was the person who established the rights of all women in all places and for all times. How could it ever be that, on the one hand, the Holy Prophet ﷺ proclaimed that paradise lay under the feet of one's mother, and that half of Islamic faith could be learned from Aisha, and yet, on the other hand, stated that, God forbid, women were hell-bound? As I said, this is impossible, and such claims are the result of the ignorant and false interpretations given by some clerics solely to satisfy their own interests. This hadith was actually a great favor upon all womankind by the Holy Prophet ﷺ, as he warned them and showed them the path to salvation and brandished a spiritual torch guiding them towards the path of Allah. Thus, no Muslim woman should ever have any complex whatsoever about their status, and nor should they ever accept any false interpretation of this hadith. The correct interpretation is that women should, just like men, try to remove their weaknesses and should pursue secular and religious education and use their knowledge to defend Islam and for the sake of the moral training of their future generations. The younger girls present should also understand the importance of education and should try to excel in their schools and colleges whilst also striving for religious knowledge. Even at our young age, at your young age, you should keep in mind that your education is the means through which you will, inshallah, come to serve Islam. Never bear any complex about your faith, whether in regard of Islamic teachings or in terms of the observance of your faith. For example, you should always wear modest clothing and confidently explain to others that you are not forced to wear such clothes. Rather, you choose to dress modestly, having understood the deep wisdom underpinning your faith. Similarly, from a young age, Waqfat-e-Nau girls must be regular in namaz. Remember that the 5 daily prayers are obligatory from the age of 10, and so try to offer your prayers with proper concentration and with the aim of increasing your connection with Allah. May Allah enable all of you to understand and act upon what I have said today. May Allah help all of you to fulfill the demands of your pledge as member of the Waqfat-e-Nau scheme. Ameen. Now join me in silent prayer. Ameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.